ZIGZAG in One, a place where we honestly discuss how to embrace the zigs and the zags in our crazy lives. Running away is not an option. Living in defeat is not an option. Instead, learning how to keep moving forward is what we'll do together, one nugget of wisdom at a time. Your host is Melanie Brown. She's navigated a few zigs and zags in her life with the determination to never give up. Expect great stories and lots of laughs. Are you ready? Let's do it.
Thank you for joining me for today's episode of the ZIGZAG in One podcast. I'm your host, Melanie Brown. Gratitude has to be one of my favorite topics. And my guest today, Janice Kaplan, is with me to discuss her book, The Gratitude Diaries. This New York Times bestselling book shares Janice's personal takeaways from 12 months of practicing gratitude. She did that in her marriage, with her sons, at work, in friendships, in nature, and many more other topics. Additionally, she cites in-depth research from leading experts in many fields about the benefits of practicing gratitude. As Janice writes, gratitude may be the secret sauce for happiness. Janice is the author of 15 books, hosts a podcast called The Gratitude Diaries, and she speaks across the country. Previously, she was the editor-in-chief of Parade magazine and produced more than 30 network television shows. She was a busy woman. While at Parade, Janice ran a cover story on the soon-to-be President Obama, in which he wrote a letter to his daughters describing what he hoped for them and their future. Janice has also interviewed many recognizable names from Hollywood, including Matt Damon, Daniel Craig, Barbara Streisand, and Morgan Freeman. She's married to Ron, and they have two sons. I especially enjoyed reading about how her gratitude project impacted her husband and sons, because I know for my own family, seeing what she did gives me great ideas for how I can express gratitude to my husband and sons. But before you join me for my interview with Janice, I want to share these words from her last chapter. By living gratefully, I'd had the happiest 12 months I could remember. Now that's great incentive for me and hopefully for you to put into practice what we learned today. Please join me for my conversation with Janice Kaplan. Janice, I am so super excited to have you with us today.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
I wish the audience could see my copy of your book. It is covered with yellow sticky notes, pinpointing exactly all of the quotes and the topics that really impacted me. And I'm telling you, I could ask you 1,000 questions based on all that I picked out from your book. But we don't have all that time, so I'm going to start with some questions and we can get started.
Well, I love seeing those sticky notes. I'm glad it inspired. I'm excited to talk more about it.
That's the teacher in me. If I see something that's meaningful to me, I got to make sure and note it.
Good.
So what year did you start doing this gratitude project?
Oh, gosh. The book came out about 4 or 5 years ago now. And I was writing and researching and living the year at the same time. And the inspiration for the book was I had just left as the editor-in-chief of Parade magazine, and a large foundation asked me to do a survey on gratitude. And I didn't know a whole lot about the subject at the time, but that sounded like a fun thing to do. So I did the survey, and the results started coming in, and they were just stunning. It was something like 95% of people said that they thought grateful people were happier. And then when we asked people, are you grateful for family and friends? Again, 90, 95% of people said absolutely grateful for family and friends. And then we asked, and your listeners can think about this, then we asked people, do you express gratitude? And then the numbers just plunged. Then all of a sudden, instead of 95%, it was under half. And so I started to realize that we have a big gratitude gap, right? We have something that we know is going to make us happier, but we just don't do it. And as I describe in the book, there was a New Year's Eve where I started to realize that I was as guilty of it as anybody else. And on that night, I decided I was going to challenge myself and see what would happen if I spent a year living more gratefully.
Well, the statistics are probably very true in my life and a lot of other people's lives. I love gratitude and I love expressing it, but I often remember, oh, you haven't said thank you to so-and-so in a while, and you haven't this in a while. And gratitude, like you said, is something that we all know makes us happier, and yet we don't do it as often as we should. What I loved most about your book is all of the research that you pulled. There were so many learned scholars and psychologists and researchers and scientists that you drew from their research, and you included that. I was overwhelmed with the information that was shared. In fact, one psychologist, Dr. Robert Emmons, concluded you don't need good events in your life in order to feel gratitude. Instead, grateful people reframe whatever happens to them. They don't focus on what they're lacking. They make sure they see the good in what they have. That struck me hard because we all have so much. And as you said in your book, in America, we are wealthy compared to many other nations. We have much, and we often forget to be thankful for that.
Yeah, well, onto the first part of your question, having a lot of research is always important to me. I've been a journalist for most of my career. And while this book was a bit of a memoir, you know, because it was my year of living gratefully, I was going to support everything that I experienced or believed with actual research. So I spoke to neurologists and psychologists and doctors and Nobel Prize winners and a wonderful array of people. And for me, one of the great joys of writing books is that I get to talk to a lot of smart people. And the comment you made about reframing, I think, is absolutely key. And it's a key to gratitude. Because, you know, a lot of us start by saying, all right, as I tour the country and talk about gratitude, I hear people say all the time, you know, well, I'll be grateful when I have something to be grateful for. Mm. And you tell those people, you're never going to be grateful. Life doesn't work that way. You know, every event that happens in our lives has a good and a bad to it. There's a flip side to everything. And you can always stop and reframe a situation. And to me, that sense of reframing and looking at things from a different perspective is really so much of what gratitude is about. Gratitude doesn't say everything in life is wonderful. And gratitude doesn't say, oh, let's only look at the bright side of life. It says there is good and bad. And some psychologists say we're actually wired to see the negative, that evolutionarily it made sense for us to know where danger was, for us to know where problems were. It didn't make so much sense for us to know how to stop and smell the flowers. Well, life has changed since then, and we do need to be able to stop and see the good sides. And I find myself quite literally doing that. Sometimes I'll be walking down the street. I live in New York and I can get frustrated about something or upset about something. And I'll actually physically stop and go, wait a minute, you wanted to be here. Why did you want to be here? And think about something good and what's making you happy about this day. And just that little moment of doing that for yourself can make really an enormous difference.
I agree. One of the things in that quote said, they see the good in what they have. And you brought up that there is a word, habitation. And how did this word kickstart your year of gratitude?
Well, I think you're talking about habituation. Getting used.
Oh, sorry.
To
it. Yes, yes.
So habituation just basically means that you get used to stuff. And whatever we all think that we want something, right? And we all think that something there is going to make us happy. If I had a bigger house, if I had a nicer car, if I had more money, if I had just one more room in my apartment, life would be wonderful. And then, of course, we get those things and they become the new baseline. We become used to them. And So what do? Well, you can decide you need a bigger house, a bigger car, or a bigger diamond, and you can just keep upping the ante that way. But obviously, it's kind of never going to work. And so the much better idea is to pause and appreciate what you have right now. I think it's really important to say that appreciating what you have right now doesn't mean you can't want something else. And I think some people are afraid of gratitude because they think that it means, oh, I'm just giving in and being all soft and sappy and saying everything is okay. No, it's saying when I can still be ambitious, I can still, you know, try to save money so I can get that bigger house, but for right now, I'm going to be really happy with the house I have. There's always somebody who has something nicer than you do, and we always are looking upwards rather than downwards. And I think it's, or, you know, not, I don't mean it that way, but I think it's really important to appreciate that there are people who do have less than us, and to sometimes take a look at that. And it's also not a game of comparison. It's a game of appreciating where you are, what you have, and then being able to move on from there.
When I read that part of your book, I put the book down and I walked around our house and I thought about some of the things in our house that once upon a time were those new shiny things. And one thing that comes to mind is we don't have original artwork in our house at the point in time that we bought something. It was a brand new, our very first real piece of art. And we had saved up for it. We picked out the artist. It now hangs above our fireplace. It's something that brought me such joy just seeing. And I think over the years, as you said, I kind of got used to it. And when I read that in your book, I went straight to it because I knew that was something that I had taken for granted. And I had forgotten to appreciate the beauty and the joy that it brought me. And so I think that concept is something that permeates our lives, no matter if it's things or people or jobs. And that kind of leads me to our next question. You decided to focus each month on a different topic or a different person or concept to be grateful for and to focus that on. And you started with your husband. Tell me about how that changed you as you incorporated being grateful for him, for your marriage over the course of that month.
You know, it's very much what we were just talking about in terms of habituation, right? Of getting used to things. I have a really wonderful husband, and I've also been married a really long time. And you kind of stop noticing each other. And by the way, in terms of upping the ante, it's easier to trade in a car than a husband. So, so I thought it would be a good idea to try to appreciate the wonderful man I was married to. And I started it in absolutely the simplest way, as I describe in the book. We were lucky enough to have a house that we go to on weekends in the country. And we were driving there one Friday night. And when we got there, we pulled in. And I hadn't yet told my husband about, this was the beginning of January, right at the very start of my year of living gratefully, where I had just gotten the idea. And I hadn't even told my husband what I was doing yet or what the concept was. So when we pulled into our house, and I turned to him and I said, "Honey, thank you for driving." And he looked at me and he said, "I always drive." And I said, "Yeah, I know you always drive, but it's dark and snowy and I don't like to drive, and thank you." And he didn't say much at that point. And over the course of the weekend, I thanked him for many more things that every day I decided to find something to thank him for. And maybe it was things that he does all the time that I had just not noticed. And at the end, again, didn't say what this was about, but the vibe between us started to change. And at the end of the weekend on Sunday night, we were having dinner. Then he turned to me and he said, "Honey, thank you for cooking." And, you know, and I said, "I always cook." But at that point, I told him what the project was. And just that ability to notice each other, to thank each other, and to appreciate each other was an enormous, enormous change. And it truly did change the feeling between us. And, you know, I've since joked that I thought I was going to be grateful to my husband for the first month of my project. I thought that was more than enough. But it worked out so well that I certainly continued that way for that whole year and for all the years since. And, you know, he's the one who will often remind me, if things get, you know, grumpy between us, as they can between any spouses and partners, you know, he'll say, "Hey, Ms. Gratitude, is that how you want to feel?" And you realize, no, it's not. You know, I'm with the person I love and care about, and that's the person that I should try to appreciate and be grateful to. By the way, a quick side story to that is that, you know, that survey we started out talking about, in that survey we found out that people are more likely to express gratitude to the barista at the coffee shop or the guy who delivers their groceries than they are to their spouse. And, you know, I think the reason is that we have such high expectations for our spouses and partners, and we want them to be everything to us. And, let's appreciate who they are and not always be demanding more.
I loved all the stories that you told about your gratitude time with your husband and how you realized how that enriched your marriage. And then you moved in to your kids. And I loved hearing about how you told them things about what they were doing and who they were and how you were grateful for them. And one of the things that I highlighted in my yellow Siggy notes was that gratitude overrides a sense of entitlement. And as working with students all of these years and having boys of my own, kids can have that sense of entitlement. And how did you find that the gratitude kind of lessened or reduced that sense of entitlement that your sons felt?
Well, I think there are several different ways that you use gratitude with kids. And one is simply to appreciate your children. And, you know, children want to be admired and they want to feel like they're doing a good job. And parents are really good at being critical most of the time.
Yes, they are.
Telling them everything they're doing wrong. And start with what they're doing right. You know, if your child brings home a report card that has four A's and one C, your immediate reaction is usually going to be like, "Ooh, having a lot of trouble in math, aren't you? Let's talk about that C and what's wrong in math." Start with the A's. Congratulate them on the A's. Get excited about that. Make that the focus. And then you can get to the problem. The problem's not going to go away. It still has to be dealt with. But just change the perspective so that your kids feel appreciated. They will respond to that. On the question of entitlement, I think kids only know what we show them, right? We think that children are so influenced by social media and all of that, but they're really influenced by the very small circle that they live in, their friends and their family. And I think parents do their children a great service by trying to let them see other parts of the world and trying to let them see that there are others who aren't as fortunate as they are. I suggest in the book one very simple thing that I've always done and that I have suggested to many people who I know also do it now, which is, you know, all of those requests for donations you get in the mail.
Yes.
You know, usually you just throw them away, except the ones that you really care about. Well, instead of doing that, throw them into a basket. And then once a month or twice a year or once a year, whatever your time frame may be, sit down with the whole family. And mom and dad get to decide what the budget is. And the kids get to decide where the money is going to be donated. And it ends up giving some really wonderful discussions of realizing the very many, many different kinds of issues there are in the world, the kinds of poverty and deprivation and illness. You can focus on just issues about children, and you'll end up with really exciting family discussions about, you know, do we want to help the children who are refugees, or do we want to help the children who are in the hospital? It just opens everybody's eyes. It just makes everybody think in a slightly different way. And you don't have to make any large moral statements about it. You don't have to make any, it's not a point for lecture. The kids are going to get it, and they're going to realize it. And those are, my children still talk about some of those discussions as having been really important to them and things that they remember.
I think that is a fantastic exercise to take. And it's good for us to also, as adults, understand that there are others that need help. And that is a fantastic way to do that. The next chapter talked about no complaining. And boy, I think all of us could use a month of gratitude to undo the mumbling and the grumbling that we all are guilty of. But you shared a downside to positivity that came out during that month that I double underlined because it struck so true. And you said, I suddenly found myself excessively sensitive to people who weren't grateful. Talk about that for a minute.
Yeah, you know, it's like being a reformed smoker. You feel so good. And you go like, how could anybody still be doing this? And I had at least one friend who is just had a lot of trouble with gratitude, and she has a very lovely life, but she could always find the negative in everything. And I found it very difficult to talk to her. I would always be pointing. Those people, when you're starting, you don't want to understand the others. She's still a good friend, and we still joke about it, and she'll still call me and say, I thought of you yesterday, and here's what I did positive. So I think all you can do with people who are constantly negative is to try to be the role for how to look at things differently.
Hey there, I just completely lost you.
Oh.
Okay. Oh, no. Okay, can we do that one question again?
You missed the whole thing?
I missed where you started. So if I could do, tell me about that, and then you go from there and talk about your friend. I as soon as you started talking, I was like, oh, no. And we've got some bad weather here. It doesn't look like it's a problem right now, but apparently cause that, I guess.
Okay.
So we're going to start just now. So tell me about that.
Yeah, it can be a problem when people don't share your positive outlook. I had at least one friend who did manage to see the negative side of everything. And she had a very lovely life. And I found it very frustrating to be with her. And she knew I was writing about gratitude. And so I was very blunt in pointing it out to her. And we have remained friends. And at this point, she'll call me and say, you know, I thought of you yesterday, and here's how I tried to be positive. I think all you can try to do is be a role model for people and to look at the positive side. And I think people who are often negative feel that there is somehow something intellectually superior about being negative, that they are seeing the real world and you are seeing the world through rose-colored glasses. And what's really important to realize is that, no, you're both right. There is good and bad in any situation, but it's nice to be able to balance it out. And there's certainly nothing superior or intellectually superior about being negative to being positive.
I love hearing you say that she'll call you and say, I tried to be positive. That's fantastic, because it shows me, as you said, you're being a role model and you're rubbing off on her. That's just great. I love it. In the spring, you focus on being grateful for money and career and the stuff we own. And you shared behavioral economist Tom Gilovich's findings that people get more lasting joy from experiences than objects. And I know that to be true in our lives, because the experiences that we have, we can go back to those memories time and time again, but objects wear out. What did you find during those 3 months?
Well, it's exactly what you just said, that it's a little bit back to the habituation we were talking about at the beginning, that you get a great sofa, and you're all excited about it, but then it's your sofa. And who's ever excited about a sofa? And experiences we relive over and over again, and they only get better. We all know that when we tell the stories of our vacations, they are so much better the more times we tell them. But experiences do bring joy, and they're also something that you never have to compete with. We were talking about comparing yourself to other people. Your experience is yours, and how you felt on your vacation or your hike or your backyard barbecue is always yours, and nobody can do that better than you did or take that away from you. And I find now that when I'm giving gifts, particularly to my children, I always give gifts of experience. Unfortunately, now I can't give gifts of theater tickets, which is what I used to give, but things that people can do, because most of the time they don't really need one more bauble, but it is nice if they can have if they can go somewhere, if they can see something, if they can experience something. And it's really important for all of us to do that too. I think experiences don't have to be big, but especially in these days when so many people are home more than usual, it's nice to just try to have a slightly different perspective, to do something new and to do something that you can remember. Daniel Kahneman, who is a behavioral psychologist and economist who won the Nobel Prize, talks about the experiencing self versus the remembering self. And I love that because the experiencing self is the person who is the you who is living through an event. And the remembering self is the you who looks back on that event. And you want to make both of those happy, but the remembering self lasts for a very long time. And the remembering self is the part of you that relives those experiences and gets to be grateful for them and happy for them over and over again.
I know exactly what you're talking about. When my boys were 4 and 7, we took, the three of us took a road trip to New York. And from Atlanta to New York is quite a bit of a ways in the car with two young boys who want to complain and how much further and are we there yet and I'm hungry and I got to go to the bathroom and all of those things. We were on a shoestring budget, but we had a blast. There were so many things that happened that were funny, that were hard. Even now, they are 18, almost 19, and 22, and we can go back to that remembering self and talk about very specific things that happened. And we didn't spend hardly any money. We made peanut butter and jelly sandwiches out of the back of the car. But those memories, I am so incredibly grateful for all of these years later. And that is what you were talking about in those chapters. And I just connected with it so much based on this particular memory. So you went on. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, that's lovely. And it's absolutely right. And those are the joys. Those are the joys that life is really made up of.
Well, and I can remember being so grateful when I got back because we had all kinds of pictures and we relived them, telling my husband about all the adventures that we had. And again, we've talked about those and been grateful for those all of these years. And it is so wonderful to have those memories. Then later on, you wrote that enough would be my new mantra. You were grateful to have enough. I really love that. Tell me what you meant by that.
We all have enough, right? What we have is enough. We can find the joy in what we have. Oftentimes when I give talks on the Gratitude Diaries, a friend of mine who is a Hollywood producer had put together a tape for me. She does a lot of celebrity interviews. And when the book first came out, she asked a lot of celebrities about gratitude. And we put together a video, about 3 minutes, of some of the biggest celebrities in the world talking about why they're grateful and what they're grateful for. And it's fun to watch. But then I realized that a lot of people would be looking at it and thinking, well, of course they should be grateful. You know, they're celebrities. He was James Bond. Of course he should be grateful. But then think of how many people are looking at each of us and each of your listeners and wishing and thinking, why aren't you grateful for what you have? Look how much you have. And if each of us could think of it that way and take a step back from ourselves and appreciate what's around us and what we have, I think it can make a huge difference.
Enough really is the right thing. And more is not necessarily better. Just
correct.
Like that shiny new thing. We get right. Used to it and we don't appreciate it anymore. One of the chapters that I really loved, because it affects most of us, is when you focused on your job. And you got really bold that month because you said to a friend of yours that you were going to write 3 things about your job every single day for that month that you were grateful for. So when we do the math there, that is 90 things to be grateful for about your job. Now, did you start repeating yourself?
Well, you know, I think gratitude at work comes in both directions. You want to be grateful for the job that you have, and you want to express gratitude on the job too. And for people who work, you know that, well, right now a lot of us are working from home, but you tend to spend more time either at your job or somehow involved with your job than you do with almost anything else. And yet, once again, in that survey, people were less likely to express gratitude at work than any place else. I think it was like 9% of people were likely to express gratitude at work. And over again, when I was doing the research, I was finding that bosses were very reluctant to say thank you to people who worked for them. It was sort of that old Mad Men era attitude of, you know, we say thank you with a paycheck. And I wanted to say, no, you don't say thank you with a paycheck. You say thank you with thank you. You say we're paying you with a paycheck. And I think when people realize that and that people want to be appreciated at work, it can make a huge difference. It can just make people feel, we see it over and over again, that the people who know that they are doing something that matters, like teachers and doctors and nurses who know that they're contributing, feel good about their work. And everybody wants to feel good about their work. Everybody wants to feel appreciated in some way. And so I think if bosses can learn to do that and to say thank you to the people who work for them, if you're in an environment where that doesn't happen, say thank you to your colleagues. Life is not a competition. Help each other at the same level, and get that good feeling going that way.
And you're right about the workplace. There often is not a lot of thank you that goes between people who work together. I will say, though, teachers are really good about that. If a teacher all of a sudden has held her pee for as long as she possibly can, and she knocks on the neighbor's door and says, will you watch my class so that I can run down the hall to the restroom? I mean, that teacher is getting a thank you, and she is getting her favorite Diet Coke or whatever it is that she drinks. And I mean, we all take care of each other and we appreciate each other. But I remember a specific time where I had helped to start a program at a school, and things were going well. And even though we had a few glitches, the program itself was doing amazing things to help students be more successful. And one day I went to my mailbox, and there was a note in my mailbox that I recognized the handwriting on there as my principal's handwriting. And when I opened it, I mean, tears came to my eyes, because she had done exactly what you're talking about. She had thanked me for all the hard work. She had been very specific in what she said. It wasn't just thank you. It was very specific about what I had done and how it was making a difference. And I kept that for a very long time. And when I was having a rough day, I would go back and look at it. And you're right, because you spend so much time in the workplace, those people are important. And to know that they are grateful for you makes you work harder. It makes you feel appreciated. It makes you understand that you are having an impact. So I loved that chapter, although I still am enamored that you found 90 things over the course of 30 days. So that was a big goal that you met there.
And that's a lovely story about your principal. And that's exactly what should happen. And the specificity you mentioned is really important, to point out what somebody did, not just, you know, a generic thank you is a place to start if you don't know what else to do. But yes, to do it specifically like that, to do it in writing, to give somebody a note, what a great thing to do.
It did mean a lot. It really did. So the next chapter was talking about the mind-body connections, and you talked about nature. And I'm just going to tell you, nature is next to gratitude. It probably comes a real close second. Mm-hmm. I could spend all kinds of time out in nature. And you made a statement that I absolutely love. We feel grateful to be part of this magical world when we spend time out in nature. What did you gain and feel grateful about during that month that you focused on your mind and body and spent time in nature?
Well, I wondered, so much of what I was writing in the book was about how to change your attitude and little things that you can do and, you know, gratitude games you can play for yourself. But I wondered if there was anything that just naturally made you feel grateful. And I tried exercise, which some people say does, and I talk about exercise a lot in the book. But I also discovered that for me, it would work if I went out and took a run outside in a beautiful place or took a walk. And I realized that it was somehow that connection to nature that does just flood you with gratitude, whether you're walking or truly exercising. And I think that there is some research about how our bodies and minds change in nature and how nature affects us in a very different way than any urban environment does. There's some research that where people who took a walk in a city responded physiologically very different than when they took a walk in nature. So I know not everybody has a beautiful spot that they can go, but fortunately there are a lot of parks in this country and there is a lot of rural area still too. So if you can find a way, it doesn't have to be every day, it doesn't even have to be every week, but if you can find a way to get yourself outside to some place where you can just appreciate the trees and the birds and the beauty around you, it connects you. It does. It connects you to the world in a different way, and it gives you a sense of gratitude to the bigger world.
Well, one thing I want to talk about before we wrap up is your gratitude diet. I thought that was just incredible. So talk to me about that.
Well, I decided that, you know, if gratitude was helping with everything else, there should be a gratitude diet. And I came up with my own gratitude diet, and it had 3 points. So let me see if I can remember all of them. The first was to just appreciate the things that you eat and to take a full moment to appreciate what you're eating. You know, we all tend to just shove stuff in our mouth and not really think about it. And so that tied into the second one, which is that there was no eating on the go, you know, no eating in the car because you can't stop to appreciate it there. And then the third, which sounds like it's obvious, but it's really not, but to only eat things that you really like. And so, you know, I have a friend who actually did write a diet book, and he was appalled that my gratitude diet allowed a chocolate cookie from my local bakery because they made me happy. And I thought, if I get to have one cookie and I can look at it and appreciate it, that's going to be good for me. And I think that if we do learn to stop and look at our food and appreciate our food and think about it, we're naturally going to eat healthier. It's really hard to be appreciative from something you've taken out of a package. But, you know, if you have a shiny peach in front of you or a newly picked apple or whatever fruits and vegetables look so nice in the grocery store, you really can stop and look at those and appreciate those. And I do think it makes a difference in what you eat and how you eat.
And I have found that to be true for myself, and he probably wouldn't like my red velvet cupcake either.
Well, there you go, though. You definitely
I can't. I don't have them very often. I'm trying to celebrate things because I know from other podcasts that I've done, it's important to celebrate small things that you accomplish or that happen to you. And so hopefully in the next few days, by the time this podcast airs, I will have finished writing my book, and it has taken me 5 years. And I assure you that I will look at that red velvet cupcake and appreciate it and be grateful for it and celebrate all in 3 big bites.
Well, good for you, and congratulations on the book.
Thank you.
Achievement, and it's worthy of at least a cupcake.
Well, I've got a few to catch up to you. Well, let's talk about your one takeaway. What do you want the listeners to remember about this show today?
Well, I think so much of what we've been talking about is perspective and reframing and how you think about things. And so I think what we realize is that we are all the spin meisters of our own lives. And whether you see that life as positive or negative is really up to you. That no event is positive or negative. It's your attitude. So be the spin meister and spin it in a positive way, and you're going to make yourself feel a lot better.
And for us to be grateful, because we can even learn things in the tough times.
Well, so, absolutely. Practice gratitude, express gratitude, and know that gratitude really can make a difference in your own happiness.
Well, Janice, it has been a true pleasure to spend time with you today. I absolutely loved this book. And I am so grateful to have the opportunity to talk to you about it today.
Well, thank you. It's really been a pleasure. And thank you for having read it so carefully and knowing it so well. It was really fun to talk to you because of that. So thank you.
Well, I've already started your next book, The Genius of Women, and I've already started my sticky notes. So we might be getting you back on the show next season so I'll that we can here. Talk about that book.
I'll be here.
So listeners, please check out the show notes for links to Janice's website and podcast that's called The Gratitude Diaries. And I've been listening to it for the last few days. It is power-packed, and it definitely points out how gratitude makes a big difference in our lives. It also will have a list of her books, because you'll want to check out not only The Gratitude Diaries, but the other ones that she has written. I am so thankful for you joining us today, and may I encourage you to find ways to show gratitude and spread it everywhere you go. Well, did you grasp how much gratitude impacted Janice's life? I know we all could agree that 2020 has been a tough year. I wonder, though, if you've paused and considered all the wonderful things that have happened in your life this year. Did you express gratitude for them? Or maybe you wrote them in a journal. I know I've benefited greatly when I recorded things, big and small, that I'm grateful for in my gratitude journal. In fact, you are recorded in my gratitude journal. I want to express my gratitude to you for listening to this episode and any others that you've listened to. You are the reason I do this. I am so grateful for your support and when you share this podcast with your friends. My goal is to share interviews and strategies that are truly helpful to you. It makes my heart so happy when I get feedback that an interview has encouraged someone who is struggling, or the strategies like gratitude or rest or maintaining a positive attitude have strengthened you during your journey of overcoming. As we end season two, I want to also thank all the incredible guests who've been part of the show. Your stories of overcoming were inspirational and encouraging. Learning the strategies that you incorporated in your lives during your struggles gave us strategies and tools that we can implement when we face life's tough challenges. Did you catch episode 28 with Dr. Sandra Dalton Smith? If you haven't, please take a listen, because I'm following her recommendation about practicing rest until January. But I assure you, dear friends, season three is shaping up to be another incredible season. Until we connect again in January, keep moving forward.